how can we manipulate Heisenberg's Uncertainty Principle to do cool stuff with it? In this video, we'll be looking at how we can squeeze light in a very unusual way to give us some interesting results. If you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. Let's get into it. The first thing we need to look at is what Heisenberg's Uncertainty Principle actually tells us. Now, I've made a detailed video about this already. Check it out up here if you haven't seen it. But basically, the gist is that when we use the theory of quantum mechanics to predict things like the position or the momentum of a particle, we cannot predict it with perfect precision like we can in classical physics. For example, a classical tennis ball starting here and moving in this direction at this speed will be found exactly here a time t later. But a quantum particle is more complicated. We can only know a range of positions that it can be found in, meaning we are uncertain about its position measurement. And the same is true for the momentum of the particle. Now, the uncertainty principle deals with the uncertainties in two measurements that are related to each other, or in other words, are known as conjugate variables. The most common example of this is, in fact, position and momentum of a particle along the same direction. These two quantities are conjugate variables, and when we measure them, their uncertainties must obey the uncertainty principle. When we multiply these two uncertainties together, the result is always greater than or equal to h bar divided by 4. H bar is the reduced Planck constant, which for our purposes right now is just a constant or a number. Another way to think about this is that we cannot know exactly the position and the momentum of a particle at the same time. The more we know about one, the less we know about the other. Even in a minimum uncertainty state, where the product of these uncertainties is as small as possible. Now, a similar sort of thing also applies to the properties of a light wave. You may be familiar with the idea that light waves can be thought of as vibrations of the electromagnetic field. The field wobbles in this direction, say, and the wave transfers energy from left to right in this instance. But in quantum theory, it turns out this picture of an electromagnetic wave, or light, becomes too simplistic. It turns out we cannot exactly know the amplitude or the phase of a light wave in quantum mechanics. The amplitude is basically just a measure of how much the electric and magnetic fields jiggle. Bigger jiggling equals a higher intensity wave and a higher amplitude. And phase is just a measure of how far along a wave cycle we are. We generally choose to say that this point is the start of a wave cycle, and we label it with a phase of 0 degrees. And then we go through one full wave cycle, the equivalent of going around a full 360 degrees, or 2 pi radians. Now, both degrees and radians are measurements of angles, but we'll stick with degrees for now since that's what most people are familiar with. If you aren't sure about why we measure phase as an angle in terms of degrees, I'll leave some resources down in the description below. But for now, all we need to know is that the phase is just a measure of how far through the cycle we are. It tells us whether we're at the beginning, or at the first peak, or at the middle of the cycle, or at the trough, or at the end of the first cycle, which is equivalently the beginning of the next cycle. Now, in quantum mechanics, we cannot perfectly accurately know both the amplitude and the phase of any light we happen to be studying. There is some uncertainty in both quantities. A really simple way to represent this on our graph is like this. All this tells us is that our light wave can have a range of amplitudes, this being the smallest and this being the largest, and it can have a range of phases as well, from here to here. This last bit just says that as the wave travels through space, we cannot be sure exactly what part of the cycle the wave is through at, say, this point, which we can call point X at a time t. It could be exactly halfway through the cycle as the wave passes this point, or it could be slightly further ahead or a bit further behind as well. All of this uncertainty can be thought of in a few different ways, but here's one that I find convenient. If we were theoretically able to produce the exact same waves over and over again from the same source, we could make measurements on each one of these waves for the amplitude and for the phase at each point in space and time. And when we make a measurement, we do find exact results. After all, this is what making a measurement is in quantum mechanics. And this is known as the collapse of the wave function. More on this idea in the video linked up here. But the thing is, we could try to generate the exact same wave in the exact same way from the same source over and over, and yet we would not find the exact same amplitude and phase measurements for each wave. This is where the uncertainty comes in. A source cannot produce the exact same waves over and over, even by doing the exact same thing. This is a property of the universe in the theory of quantum mechanics, and not just a dodgy wave source. In other words, everything behaves like this. Therefore, we deal with this as an uncertainty in the amplitude and phase of the waves created by a source. This diagram just refers to the likely amplitudes and phases we could measure for the next wave created by the source, since we cannot know exactly how it will look beforehand. Okay, from this sketch, we can vaguely see that the uncertainty in the phase is about the same as the uncertainty in the amplitude. Now, this diagram is a terrible way to show that, because I could just choose to draw one axis differently, and then the uncertainties would look different, even though they're representing the exact same thing compared to earlier. But let's just imagine we choose a particular set of axis labels and stick to it. So any changes in this diagram are actual changes in the uncertainties of one of these quantities. With this quantum state, the uncertainties happen to be the same in both if we work in natural units. The units are not particularly relevant here. But remember, the amplitude and phase are obeying an uncertainty relation. So the product of these two uncertainties has to be greater than or equal to this number here. In this particular case, we're looking at the minimum possible uncertainty, meaning the product of these two quantities is the lowest possible value it is allowed to be. But here's something cool we can do. We can actually lower the uncertainty in one of these quantities. For example, here's what a new wave diagram would look like. We can see that we're much more sure about what the phase of our wave is. It's now in a much smaller possible range. But in order to make up for this, and in order to ensure our wave still obeys the uncertainty relation, the uncertainty in the other quantity, amplitude, has increased. We are now much less sure about the amplitude of our wave because it can be one of a much bigger range of amplitudes. This type of light is said to be in a squeezed state because we have squeezed the uncertainty in one quantity. But of course, this is compensated for by an increase in the uncertainty in the other quantity. And interestingly, we can actually squeeze waves in the other quantity as well, in amplitude, reducing its uncertainty, and the uncertainty in the phase increases to compensate. So the product of the uncertainties of the two quantities is at least the minimum allowed value. Basically, we've just seen two ways to manipulate the uncertainty relation to create new and interesting quantum states. But what is the point of doing this? What are the applications? Well, we can imagine that the reduced uncertainty might help us in making measurements with these light waves that depend on the quantity that has been squeezed. At the time that I'm recording this video, there's a detailed description of how squeezed light can be used in a laser interferometer, not to improve the output signal, but rather to reduce the noise in the measurements. I'll leave a link to that down below if you want to know more. And squeezed light has been used in the LIGO experiment that first detected gravitational waves too. More on that in a future video on this channel. For now though, I'm going to finish up here. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. Check out my merch linked down below in the description as well. It's a quantum dice design based on a famous quote from Albert Einstein. I also want to say a huge thank you to my Giga patrons and to all of my other patrons as well. If you'd like to support me on Patreon, then there's a link to that down below as well. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.